you make some Holy Ghost crazy noise right now. Let me hear. Come on, Zion, clap those hands with me. Come on, come on, all God's people. Come on, come on, Mike. Do them up like this, do them up like this, come on. Here we go, let's go.
Come at grace.
find love at grace, spread peace at grace, find joy at grace, said you're welcome here, all are welcome here, we welcome you to Grace Congregational.
Woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. Woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. Woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Let us pray. Dear Father, Mother God, we thank you so much for waking us up this morning. It's a new day. It's a new week. Another chance for us to be blessed and to bless and be thankful. We thank you for this opportunity to walk with you one more day. We pray that you will use us this day to be of service to others. We praise you, we worship you, and we magnify your name. Dear Lord, bless us and watch over us as we navigate this existence. Help us to reach out to others when we need help and to reach out to others when they need help. We are all on this tiny ball together. We need each other to survive. We pray for those who are experiencing loss this day. Last week, their loved one was with them, and this week, they are with you. Bless those who mourn. Let them feel your love and compassion. We pray for those who are graduating from preschool, elementary school, middle school, high school, college, and graduate school. We thank you for being with them and their families as they studied and struggled all these years. Bring them the success that only you can bring. Dear Lord, we thank you for fathers, grandfathers, and uncles. We celebrate them today. Dear God, we are so thankful for their love and guidance. As we think about them today, we laugh, we cry, and we remember. Dear God, we also celebrate Juneteenth today, our country's real Independence Day. This is a day we celebrate the independence of all of our citizens. Bless and keep our pastor and his family as they travel overseas. We pray that they have a good time and return to us happy and relaxed. Dear God, be with the preacher this morning. Speak through him so that we hear your message for us today. And now, as you taught us to say, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Greetings, Grace Church, and I greet you in the matchless, the amazing name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And I greet you this morning from Paris, Paris. Bonjour. It is a wonderful place to be and a place to just soak up all the creativity. Of course, some of my favorite writers, Victor Hugo, Les Miserables, and of course, Marcel Proust, and Josephine Baker, and of course, who walked up these streets, but James Baldwin himself and Richard Wright. And of course, Ta-Nehisi Coates now lives here. So there is just something about the cafes. And of course, we've been to the museums, the Louvre, where we've seen some beautiful pictures of Mona Lisa and Rembrandt and all of those things. So we're just delighted to be here and to experience all of this creativity and this culture as well. So God bless you. We return today and we'll be in your midst this week. And of course, we have Wednesday night, is Sermon Speak Back. So come talk with us and let's talk about the sermon that you'll hear today. And of course, we have a special Father's Day blessing. Shout out to all fathers, those who have played a big role in our lives as a fatherly figure. And we're just grateful because fathers make a difference. Fathers have a priestly role in a household, and they have the fatherly role that gives us the sense of comfort of who we are, and of course, our Father in heaven. So we celebrate all fathers today, amen. Nothing has changed me like being a father to Sierra and that unconditional love and how she looked up to me that I could change the world for her. And so I am honored to be a father, and I honor all the fathers in this world today. It is also the weekend of Juneteenth Day. And so we are celebrating Juneteenth Day. And this is the first time. So I remember what Mandela said. He said, to be free is not merely to cast off one's chains, but to live in a way that respects others and enhances the freedoms of others. So may we not only celebrate the end of slavery, but also the end of spiritual slavery for those that are still in bondage, and we live in a way that sets people free. God bless you. Enjoy the today and happy Father's Day. Blessings to all. Amen.
Peace is where you are. Joy is where you are.
Good morning, Grace Church. First of all, let me thank God for this beautiful day, a day that brings the promise of salvation for those who are to rise, and a day that invites the rest of us to be the best that God wants us to be. Amen. I also want to thank God for getting us up this morning. Some in our midst may not be with us today, but God has chosen to wake us up for this church, for this community, for this world. Thank God, Grace Church, that we are awake today. Amen? And I want to thank Dr. Pierce. Dr. Pierce invited me to be with you this morning, out of his craziness, I guess. But I want to thank him for this honor. Amen, amen. Now, on this Father's Day, I'd like to focus on a scripture that is very powerful and speaks to, I believe, what is essential about this day. I would invite you, if you have them, to open your Bible to Matthew 3, 13 to 17. Here we have the description of the baptism of Jesus. It's a very familiar story, and one that is found in all the synoptic Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. If you read the three versions in either one of those Gospels, you will see that there's a slight difference in each one of them, but essentially they're the same. I've chosen Matthew today because I believe it has something very specific to say. Let me read it aloud. Matthew 3, 13 to 17. Then Jesus came from Galilee to the Jordan to John to be baptized by him. John would have prevented him, saying, "I need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me?" But Jesus answered him, "Let it be so now, for thus it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness." Then he consented. And when Jesus was baptized, he went up immediately from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting on him. And lo, a voice from heaven saying, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased." Did you sense it? Did you feel it at the end? Something very important happens when a father shows up. Let me say that again. Something very important happens when a father shows up. Some weeks ago, when your pastor asked me if I would be willing to stand with you today, I said yes. And I entered into moments of prayer about Father's Day. I was blessed by this invitation because it gave me the opportunity to sit down in prayer and consider the meaning of today and what it might say to me and what it might say to you. I prayed over the meaning of fatherhood. I reflected on my own father of blessed memory. I prayed prayers of deep thanksgiving for my own life as a father of three amazing human beings. I also prayed prayers of thanksgiving for those countless throngs of men in my life who were there as father figures to show me a path and to light the way that I might become a better man. In those prayers, I realized that the greatest blessings of my life came on September 29th, on June 6th, and on January 28th, when my wife and I became parents. And I was ushered into that royal fraternity of men called Daddy. Now, being a dad has taught me many things. It's taught me how to pray. Praying as a parent is a different type of prayer. It teaches you how to pray for things that are really important. The night our first son was born, I put him in a cardboard box and set him beside our bed because our bed was actually on the floor. And I kept my hand on him and I prayed all night that he would keep breathing. That was a different kind of prayer. When I sent them off to school for the first time with those little backpacks and those lunch boxes, and they walked down the street to a place that was foreign to me because I hadn't been in those schools, I prayed that they would come home safely. A prayer that has a very specific meaning in this day and time in this country. I remember when the boys got their driver's license in New York City. Talk about prayer. Sending your boys out in this traffic with a car that they had barely been in behind the wheel. That's a prayer. Also, being a parent or being a dad teaches you how to sacrifice, how to give things up that don't have that much of a meaning, or things that have a lot of a meaning, but there's something more important in your life. You let it go for those children. There's a story that I tell that my wife gets tired of hearing, but it's true. When our second child was born, actually before I got married, I had a lovely 1955 Jaguar XK140, a roadster, the pride of my life until I married, until my children came. Now, it just so happens when my second child was born, that car was in the shop. And they wanted $800 to get that car out of the shop. It was the exact figure that I had to pay Washington Hospital Center to get my second child out of the hospital. Sacrifice. That car never ran again. I towed it from place to place, but there was always a need that came that was greater than that car, and eventually I let it go with all the memories that went with it. Being a parent also teaches you how to be patient. Patient. Anybody that has a child knows the struggle with patience. I got 100 of them, but one that really sticks in my mind is when my daughter was just entered the seventh grade, I mean the junior in high school, ninth grade. She comes home and says, "Daddy, I have a date." And she said, "You have a date?" "Yes, he's a very young man, lovely young man. He's in the drama program with me." I said, "Well, let's see." And so the evening comes and I'm waiting at the door. And in rolls this guy, and he's got hair down to his waist and a ponytail, a little bit of a funny goatee, and he slides down in my easy chair in the living room and says, "Good evening, Pops." Well, that required about all the patience a man could muster. Not to snatch that little guy up out of that chair and throw his behind out the front door before my daughter came down the steps. Needless to say, my wife was there, and they went. I watched. I waited patiently till she got home. She never dated that guy again, but there were repeats of that level of patience. The other story, quickly, is that we had a son that hated to sleep. When he was little, he just always come out of his room, always come out of his room. We finally resorted to putting a screen door hook on the outside of his door. Now, he was only 3. One night we did that, and he was beating on the door, and he said, "You can put me to bed, but you can't make me sweep. I said, you're staying in that room, boy. Required all the patience I had to deal with that child. You see, being a father is hard. Now, fathering a child and being a father are two very different things. Almost any male, when he becomes of age, can father a child. Any male can father a child. But it's an entirely different level of maturity, spiritual and emotional, to be a real godly dad. It's a whole different thing to father a child and to be a dad. Now, being a dad is challenging because no two children are alike. You quickly learn that if you have more than one child. My wife and I learned that because we had three. The eldest son was, I dare not say perfect, but he was easy. He delighted in pleasing us. He always obeyed the rules. He got good grades. He didn't give the teachers or us any problem. Number two was also a son. Now, he was adorable. He was clever. He was funny. He enjoyed entertaining people. He used to eat, that's the one that didn't stay in his room. He would come out at night when we had company over for dinner, and he would try to sing songs to them that he remembered from movies he'd seen. Everybody thought it was cute and funny. He stopped being cute when during church he decided it was okay to stand up and talk back to the preacher, who happened to be his father. Or he stopped being funny when he tell the teachers in school what he thought they were doing wrong in front of the whole class. Totally different child from the first. And then our third child was Daddy's little girl. I don't need to say any more about that. Each one of them was different and required a whole new set of energy to figure out how to father them. When we had our children, I was the new pastor in a parish. And my wife and I thought, we know how to raise kids. We worked with kids in summer programs and all that stuff, so we had it. Well, each child that came along dissuaded us of our assumptions about how easy it is to raise a child. But thank God for parish families. Thank God for all the mothers and fathers and aunties and grandmothers that are in congregations. Because they wrapped their arms around us and guided our children and guided us at the same time. And we learned a lot from them. But for each angel there was in that congregation that showed us how to be parents, there was a different way of parenting. I could hardly keep track of the do's and don'ts about what I was supposed to do depending on which mom or which dad or which auntie I was talking to. It was hard starting off being a parent. But there were some very common themes, some basic things that any good parent had to do. Men, if you want to truly earn that glorious title of father, there are some steps that you cannot skip. If you want to understand truly what it means to be a godly father, reread the baptism of Jesus at the Jordan in Mark, Luke, or Matthew. If you do a close study of both Matthew and Luke, you'll notice an important difference. In Matthew, it says John baptized Jesus. But then if you go to the Luke version, John is already in jail when Jesus is baptized. So who really baptized Jesus? Was it John? Or was it one of John's disciples who baptized Jesus? Maybe it was Mary or Joseph. They were there probably. You know, we don't really know who was at that baptism. We don't really know for sure who was there. but according to all three Gospels of the version of Jesus' baptism, we do know who did show up. God showed up. The one person who showed up for certain at the baptism of Jesus was his Father. So the very first lesson about being a real father is show up. If you want to be a father, you got to find a way to just show up. It's as simple as that. If it involves your child, you have to be there. You got to be where it's going down. If it involves your son, if it involves your daughter, being a godly father means always showing up. And if you look deeply into any of these lessons about Jesus' baptism, you realize that God doesn't simply show up, but God has something to say. This is significant when you realize that for 400 years before the baptism of Jesus, God was silent. God said nothing. The last public declaration by God came through the prophet Malachi 400 years before the birth of Jesus. For 400 years, God was mute. For 400 years, God had nothing to say to Israel. For 400 years, God is quiet, and then all of a sudden, he shows up at the Jordan River and says, I got something to say. The question we ought to be asking ourselves is that if God had been silent for 400 years, why now does God show up at the Jordan and declare, I got something to say? The answer is obvious. Because it involved his son. And the Lord said, if I'm going to show up anywhere, and if I've got something to say, if I'm going to make my presence known, I'm going to do it when it involves my child. Because real dads show up when it involves their child. Now understand this. God didn't ask Gabriel to speak for him, as he did at the Annunciation of the birth of Jesus with Mary. God doesn't say, well, since Jesus has a stepfather, Joseph, and since Jesus and Joseph seem to be tight, I'll let Joseph take my place. No. God shows up. He doesn't say, Mary, Jesus' mother, will probably be there, and since Mary and I aren't on the best of terms right now, I'm going to let Mary do whatever's necessary. No. God says it doesn't matter what your relationship is with the mother or anyone else. It's your child, and you're supposed to show up. And if you look at the scriptural passage even closer, you will notice that nowhere before the baptism of Jesus is there a prayer. There's no prayer before the baptism. That means that nobody asked God to show up. He just decided, since it's about his child, he's going to show up. Because a real dad doesn't have to be invited to part of what's going on in the life of his child. He shows up. He said, if it involves my child, I'm showing up. Now, what I'm lifting up here for you fathers, and for anyone else who's raising a child and involved in the life of a child, is the ministry of presence. The ministry of presence. Because it is in the showing up that distinguishes a father from a baby daddy. A baby daddy shows up at graduation. A father shows up at parent-teacher conferences or on Zoom, or has conversation with whoever else might be raising that child to know what's going on in that school situation. A baby daddy comes to a birthday party. A father, a real father, prays over their children night and day. Baby daddy gets a report card in the mail. A real father knows what those grades are going to be before they arrive because he has been in conversation with that child about how it's going in school. Or he may have been sitting at the kitchen table doing the math with that child. Whether the daddy is in the home or not with that child, a real daddy knows what's going on in the life of that child throughout the year, not waiting for the card in the mail. There's a real difference, gentlemen, when you show up. So the very first thing about being a real dad, a good father, is to show your presence. I mentioned reflecting on my father. My dad was an absentee father. Not that he wasn't in the house, not that he and my mom weren't married and didn't live together. He just thought that working and making money was far more important than being present. He even told us that once when we asked about going on vacation. He said, "You don't need to go on vacation with me. Go with your mother. Because if I'm going on vacation, I'm not making money." And so my dad never showed up. Except one time. One time. I changed schools in the seventh grade and joined the track team. And my father took me out to buy my first pair of cleats. And at that first track meet, all the kids had their parents there, and I knew my parents weren't going to be there. My mother was a school teacher, my dad worked. As I lined up on that starting line, I looked down there, and there was my dad, standing at the very end of the track. He'd shown up. He'd shown up for my very first track meet. I came in third in that race, and I didn't really care because my dad showed up. I remember that story because that was the last time my father showed up at any track meet. He went back to his old ways of just not showing up. But I hold that memory close. Now the second thing, as we read Matthew, is that God shows up and has something to say. God says, "Hey, that's my child." My son, the Son of God. Now, throughout the life and ministry of Jesus, there were those who witnessed his miracles, heard his preaching, felt the love of his presence, and testified that this man is the Son of God. But before Peter declared it, before Nathanael said it, before the centurion at the foot of the cross declared it and said of the crucified Christ, "This is the Son of God," God showed up at the Jordan River and said it first when he said, "Jesus is my son." You see, God sees in Jesus who he is before anybody else knows it. So the second criteria of being a really godly father is not just showing up, but seeing your child's possibilities. To recognize their potential and to speak it over them, who they are, before they even know who they are. A father. A person caring for a child. Recognizing the potential of that human being speaks over that child about who they are. What I'm saying here is that if anybody believes in your daughter, or if anybody believes in your son, it should be their father who knows whose they are and who they are. I want you to understand the significance of what happened when God does this for Jesus. This happens in chapter 3. I know you all remember what happens in chapter 4. Right after the baptism. Jesus, after his baptism, is led into the wilderness. And the very first thing that happens is that he's tempted by the devil. And Satan says to Jesus, if you are the Son of God, if you are the Son of God, I can just hear Jesus thinking right now. He's got to be looking at Satan and saying, hold up here. Didn't you hear what my daddy said? I am the Son of God. The one who has the power and dominion over all is my Father. So get thee behind me, Satan. Jesus already knows who he is because his Father told him so. And he's able to withstand whatever the devils throw his way. By speaking his possibilities and declaring his potential, God has prepared Jesus for the wilderness experience and the temptations that it'll bring when he has to stand alone and face the enemy. Dads, every time you speak the possibility of your child in their hearing, you are preparing them for their own wilderness experience, for the temptation of the enemy. They're well prepared to deal with all the mess out there because they've heard from you, their Father, who they are before the enemy challenges them. They're prepared with the knowledge of who they truly are. One other story about my father. When I was 14, he sat me down in the kitchen and said, there are people out there who I understand have been telling you that you're less than they are. There are people out there who've said because of the color of your skin and the nature of your hair and where you live, that you are less. They are not. You are not. First, because you are my son. And secondly, because of how smart you are and how aware you are and who you are. He said, and I trust that and you need to trust that too. He said, I'm going to prove how much I trust you. And it so happened that my mother's car was down at the bottom of a hill about 8 blocks away, and it was winter and it was a nighttime, and her car was dead. My father said, I'm going to take you down and you're going to drive your mother's car up that hill and I'm going to push it with my car. I said, but Daddy, I've never driven a car. I've never been behind the wheel before. He said, you can do it. You're my son and I've taught you and you can do it. He said, you also understand the power of a car. You understand that it can kill, it can hurt, as well as do good. It's that understanding that's going to let you drive that car up that hill. So we went down there, and he got his car behind Mom's car. I sat in the driver's seat, and he slowly pushed us up that hill through the night. I was scared to death, except for the fact that my father believed in me and told me that I could do it. Speak over your children who you see them to be and the potential that's in them, and they can withstand anything that's out there. Now, finally, listen to all that God declares to Jesus. First, he says, you are my son, the Son of God. Then he says, with whom I am well pleased. God declares the pride that he has in his son. Now, this is significant because God is proud of Jesus not because of what he's accomplished. Jesus, at the time of his baptism, has not performed one miracle. He hasn't given sight to the blind. He has not enabled any lame person to walk. He hasn't walked on water. He didn't even change water into wine yet. And he certainly never raised any dead to life again. God says to Jesus, "My pride in you is not connected to what you do. My pride is connected to who you are." Maybe God says this because he knows that every child, including Jesus, needs to know that their Father is proud of them. Proud. Not only is God saying in this message to Jesus that I am proud of you, he's saying, I love you. I love you. Something special happens to a child when a father says to that child, I love you. You. I love you. Fathers seem to have sometimes a hard time saying, I love you. At least, that was my experience. Now, dads, don't tell yourselves that you're too much of a man to say, I love you. Or don't say that your child doesn't need to know that you love them because you provide a roof over their head, or you provide clothing, or you put a meal on the table, and that shows love. If you say that, then you took a script from my dad. A man who never said to me, in my memory, that I love you. It wasn't until he remarried and his second wife made him say one night at the dinner table, tell your son that you love him or you're not eating at this table ever again, that my dad said, okay, I love you. I said, what? I love you. I love you. He didn't need to hear that. I said, yes, I did. But since I know that he didn't mean to say it, it didn't mean anything. Well, some years later, my father had Alzheimer's. And I was living in D.C. and he was living in Ohio, so I visited like once a month. The last visit I had with him, he didn't know who I was, and he said, why are you here? And I said, I'm your son. He said, I don't have a son. He wasn't being mean, he just didn't remember having a son. So I had him in the chair, and I was shaving him. And I had his head tipped back, and he looked up to me, and he said, Mister, why are you doing this? I said, because I'm your son, and I love you. And he said, Mister, I love you too. And he meant it. A week later, my father passed when I wasn't there. But I carry those words with me as if they were gold. The words from a father to a son that I love you. Even if he didn't know who I was, he meant it when he said it. So dads, here's what I want you to do, not only on this Father's Day, but moving forward. Very simple. Show your presence. Number one. Number two, see your child's potential and declare it to them. Let them know who they are in here. And lastly, share your pride in them and let them know that you love them. Three simple prescriptions. If you want to be a godly dad, whether you're in the house with your child or whether your child is somewhere else, you can do these things. Be present, show the child's potential and declare it, and openly admit that you love them. That stands true for Father's Day and every other day. And now let us close in prayer. Our Father in heaven, you have made yourself known to us through Jesus Christ and have invited us to pray to you as our Father, that we may pray boldly and confidently to you. Today we pray for all fathers. Give them wisdom. Give them patience. Give them the ability to love in a way that reflects your love to all of us. And we pray also for the children. Give them guidance. Give them a spirit of obedience born out of love. Give them warmth, comfort, and peace in their father's arms. We pray especially for the fatherless and for those who struggle in their families. Be their father when earthly fathers fail. Show them love and guidance, and help them to know a father's love through your love, providence, and care. Use Christian friends and other families to encourage and guide, nurture and instruct. And finally, bless them with your peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, amen, amen, and amen. Thank you, Grace Church.
I'll never be more loved than I am right now. Wasn't holding you up, so there's nothing I can do to let you down. It doesn't take a trophy to make you proud. I'll never be more loved than I am.
I know who I am. I know what you've spoken.
Father God, we come to you at this moment with gratitude in our hearts for all that you have done for us. And how can we repay you when you have given us everything and sacrificed all for us? And so, Lord God, it is only with a heart of thanksgiving that we give back to you. And so, God bless you. God bless you in your giving. Amen.
Just want to praise you forever and ever and ever for all you've done for me.
blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to you. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. Oh, just wanna praise you forever and ever and ever. Blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to you. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. One more, just wanna praise you. Blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to you. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me over and over again. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing me. Freely we give you worship. Thank you, Jesus.
Father God, we thank you, for we know no other love. We thank you for what you have done for us, for you have come to show us what unconditional love, agape love, looks like. The hands, your feet, the nails, the wounds, all that you have done. We thank you, dear Lord. How can we possibly give to this God who has given us all? Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. May the grace of God and the sweetest communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide in every household of faith, now and forevermore. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, Grace Church said, amen. May you go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen.